Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Making Homes Safer for Seniors. We're going to be getting started in just a minute or two here. Copies of the slides are available. You can see a link over on the left there called Resources. You can download the slides from there. If you want to claim CEUs for today's webinar, you'll be receiving a follow-up email by the end of the business day today that is going to connect you to the online CEU application. So watch out for that coming your way by the end of the business day today. It will be sent to the email address via which you are logged in and participating in right now. Speaking of which, if you are not logged in directly to this webcast, that is if you are listening over the phone only or are watching as part of a group, you would not be eligible for CEUs. The time limit is checked and logged for these webinars. You need to be online for a certain amount of time directly logged in. We need to see your name and email in there for our records. So if you are not directly logged into this webinar, please go back to your workstation or your office and do so at this time. There's still plenty of time for which to do so. Last 15 minutes of this hour are going to be Q&A. Now you can send in your questions at any time, but please note that we're going to wait till the last 15 minutes of the webinar to do the questions all at once. The follow-up email you're going to receive later on today will also contain a link to the slides. Please note that it will take 30 days from the date of your submission in order for us to issue your CEUs. Again, it will take 30 days from the date of your submission to issue your CEU. 30 days. You have 60 days from today for which to claim CEUs for today's session. So just a couple notes on that. I hope everybody is going to be joining us at the Aging in America conference coming up in March in Chicago. We're getting very excited for the conference as we get closer and closer here. Very exciting times here at ASA HQ, so I hope you will be joining us in Chicago. It's going to be nice and balmy out there, so bring your heavy coats. All right, today's webinar is being sponsored by Home Instead Senior Care. This webinar is part of the Family Caregiver Support webinar series, so we want to thank Home Instead for their ongoing support of this series. We're doing monthly events with them this year, and we're one event a month, and the follow-up email you're going to receive later on today is also going to contain a link to the March event in this series coming up, so watch out for that coming your way later on today. Again, thanks for joining us today, everybody. Our presenter today is Lakeland Hogan. Lakeland is a caregiver advocate for Home Instead Senior Care. She holds a graduate certificate in gerontology and is working toward a Master of Arts in Social Gerontology. She also holds a Master's in Business Administration and her undergraduate education focused on marketing and communication studies. Lakeland has professional experience in the private and public sectors of senior care services. She has worked on special projects for the University of Nebraska-Omaha's Department of Gerontology and the local area agency on aging. She is also active in her local chapter of the Alzheimer's Association. Lakeland has experience assisting senior clients and helping their families navigate the senior care continuum. She is passionate about helping others, especially aging adults and their families. And with that, I would like to turn the floor over to our presenter, Lakeland Hogan. Thanks for being here today, Lakeland.
Thanks so much for having me, Steve. Hello, everyone. I want to welcome you to today's webinar. And Steve was mentioning the ASA conference in Chicago, and I will be there. I'm really excited. So if you're going to be there, make sure you go to the vendor exhibit area. I will be at the Home Instead booth. I'd love to meet you and hear about your experience with these webinars. But today's topic is one that's really important for the quality of life of our seniors that we work with every day. And it's important to maintain their independence at home, and that topic is home safety. And so this can be a little bit of a difficult topic to broach with family caregivers because they don't want to talk to their loved one about home safety. And their loved one doesn't want to talk about it because a lot of times they feel if they have to make modifications to the home, it's admitting that they're needing help and it's taking away their sense of independence. But that the reality is that making those modifications to the home can actually keep the senior independent longer and keep them safe at home. And we'll talk more about that as we go through today's webinar. So as we transition to the next slide, I again want to point out the importance of home safety. It might seem obvious to us as professionals, but some families might not take it into account. And our research has told us that about 20 million seniors age 65 and older, they visit the emergency room each year, and about a third of those visits are related to injuries. Many of them are sustained in the home, and that's the place where seniors are meant to feel the safest. So home safety can be very important and key for seniors to be able to remain independent at home longer. So let's look at today's objectives on the next slide. Throughout our presentation today, we'll be visiting the reasons why home safety is so important. We'll also be talking about the effects on aging, the effects that aging can have on safety. And this is another way to look at the topic and to talk to family members about how they can better understand, you know, where the senior is coming from, how aging is impacting their safety in different aspects, which we'll get to in a bit. We'll also identify warning signs that a senior is struggling in the home and identify some potential dangers. And I'll walk us through each room of the house and talk about some of those key safety hazards. And then I want to end by offering up some communication tips for families on how they can talk with their loved ones about home safety issues. But first, we're going to start with a little bit of research on the next slide. Home Instead, Inc. did a survey of seniors and adult children in the U.S. and Canada, and we also did a survey of emergency room doctors, which I'm going to get to in a little bit. But first, I wanted to talk about the results that we found, particularly when it came to seniors and their adult children. So we found that of the seniors surveyed, well over one-fourth of the trips to the hospital or emergency room were caused by falls or other household accidents. And we also learned that 85% of seniors have done nothing to prepare their homes for aging. I'm going to let us stop and let that statistic set in, and I'm sure probably for a lot of you that is not a surprising statistic, but it's very high. 85% of families or seniors, they haven't done anything to prepare their home for aging. And I know when I sit down with families for the first time, many of them haven't thought about modifications that they could make or little changes that they could implement throughout the home that would safeguard against accidents. And furthermore, adult children, when they really sat down to consider the safety issues in their own loved one's home, about 65% of U.S. children and 71% in Canada could identify at least one potential safety issue. So this is something that's very prevalent in the population that we work with as professionals. And these safety issues, they range from large issues like staircases without proper handrails to smaller issues such as rugs in common walkways. But the bottom line is that safety issues can sometimes be overwhelming for adult children. And then for the seniors, they may feel unsafe in their home, and they might be ashamed to admit it or might be embarrassed to ask for help. So we need to keep those things in mind as we talk with families about this issue. And I recently experienced a home safety issue with my own grandpa. Last year, he was experiencing a lot of weakness in his knee, and he's always been very active and agile. But now, with this knee weakness, he was having to walk with a cane for assistance, and he was very stubborn, and I could just see his quality of life decreasing because he wasn't able to get around quite like he used to. And working in the aging field, I, of course, recommended that they at the very least get some grab bars installed so that he could get in and out of the shower properly, on and off the toilet properly. And my grandparents, they were pretty resistant. They said, oh, well, I'll make that call in a few weeks. Oh, we don't really need that. We're getting along just fine. But it took a near fall for my grandpa to make the phone call, pull the trigger, and actually get those grab bars installed. And luckily, he's regained a lot of strength in his knee, no longer needs the cane, but I know that he still uses those grab bars just as a safety precaution. So at the end of the day, the goal is to avoid those near falls and be proactive. But the reality can be that everyone leads busy lives, especially those family caregivers that we're working with. They might be working full-time, caring for their aging parent, their own children. They might not be living in the same environment as their senior loved one, or might be a long-distance caregiver, so they might not be aware of these home safety needs. Or it's easy for those modifications to get pushed to the back burner or delayed because of our busy lives. But these modifications can help a senior, again, remain independent at home, and it can really make a world of difference. Right. So as we transition to the next slide, we're going to take a look at what ER doctors are saying when it comes to home safety. When an accident occurs within the home, seniors are likely to end up in the emergency room, of course, and Home Instead, Inc. conducted a survey to find out what doctors are experiencing when seniors visit the ER. And these ER physicians said in the U.S. and Canada, they estimate about half of all home accidents that are experienced by a senior can be prevented. So about half the time, we can be preventing these falls, and we're going to talk a lot about the modifications that we can make in the home to prevent those falls. But when those families come into the ER, the most common response that the ER doctors get are, "We were afraid something like this was going to happen." And I'm sure you've heard these similar phrases in the clients, patients that you work with. Families recognize that there are safety issues, but they don't always know how to address them, or again, they're pushing that off to the back burner, waiting too long until something happens. And we want to be proactive and preventative as opposed to reactive when it comes to home safety. And when ER doctors are talking to families about these acts, when ER doctors, they've also indicated that having support or assistance within the home is beneficial for seniors, and it can really help to reduce the risk for accidents. So having assistance, little assistance can go a long way at home in preventing those accidents. And these ER doctors identified falls as a common reason for seniors to end up in the ER. So I wanted to take a closer look at falls on the next slide. When it comes to falls, there are several aspects of aging, of the aging process, that can really have an effect on a senior and their potential fall risk. If we consider, for example, mobility, that plays a huge part in a senior's ability to move around, and it really can impact whether or not they are at risk for a fall. So to improve a senior's mobility, there's some simple but effective things that seniors can do. First of all, of course, physical activity. It can really go a long way towards fall prevention. So with the doctor's approval, families could encourage their loved ones to be more active. Activities such as going for a walk around the block, maybe water aerobics or Tai Chi, you know, some of those gentle exercises that involve slow, graceful, almost dance-like movements. Those can really improve balance, mobility, and strength. And even chair exercises, those simple chair exercises that seniors can do right in their living room, those can really go a long way and reduce the risk for falls. It's also important to keep in mind that some seniors might avoid physical activity because they're afraid of falling. And this is where a family could turn to a physical therapist or an activity program at a local senior center where their exercise could be monitored. And physical therapists, those are a great resource. They can create custom exercise programs that are specific to the senior's needs, especially when it comes to balance, flexibility, muscle strength, and gait. And another thing to keep in mind is that family caregivers might unknowingly be prohibiting their loved one from getting some extra exercise throughout the house. And I wanted to give you an example. So if I'm a family caregiver and I'm caring for my mom and she asked me to go into her bedroom and grab her a sweater, naturally, because I'm her caregiver, I want to go and do that for her because I want to help her. But if my mom's able to get up and walk to get it herself, it might be good for me to encourage her to come along with me to show me exactly which sweater she's talking about. That way it gets her up and moving. Small bits of movement throughout the day can really add up, and it can be beneficial when it comes to mobility because they say if you don't use it, you lose it. So we need to really have family members encouraging their loved ones to get up and move throughout the day. I even know one family caregiver that went to the extreme, I guess you could say, of getting her loved one a Fitbit, and it tracked how many steps she took throughout the day. So this adult daughter, family caregiver, she was able to kind of track her mom's activity throughout the day, and then she also got one, so they would compare how many steps they would take, that sort of thing. So you can kind of think outside the box, encourage families to think outside the box on ways to get their loved one up, moving around, and staying physically active. And one last thing to keep in mind when it comes to falls and fall prevention is that medication can actually play a part. And sometimes families don't recognize that. Some medicines or a combination of medicines can have side effects such as dizziness or drowsiness. So if they're at a physician's appointment with their senior loved one, if those are some of the side effects for a medication, families need to take that seriously and monitor their loved one's mobility. They could also have a doctor or pharmacist review all of their medications to help reduce the chance of that drowsiness or dizziness side effect if possible. And there are some additional effects of aging that can impact home safety, and they're ones that, again, families might not think of right away. So let's take a look at those on the next slide. Sometimes talking about home safety in the context of the five senses is a good way to start the conversation with family caregivers. So when we talk about our five senses, you can tell the family caregiver to put themselves in their loved one's shoes and try to understand how these changes in their five senses might affect their safety. So if we start with sight, by the time someone is age 60, their pupils decrease about one-third of the size as they were when they were 20 years old. And adding to that, many seniors have eye-related conditions such as cataracts, muscular degeneration, and their world can look kind of blurry, especially as they age. And consider what might happen if a living room in a home has poor lighting, throw rugs, electrical cords crossing the pathway. You pair that with some blurry vision, and that could really be the perfect storm for an accident in the home. So sight certainly can be affected as someone ages in terms of home safety. And then when it comes to smell, our sense of smell can diminish, especially after age 70, because there's a loss of nerve endings and there's less mucus in the nose as we age. And a big concern here is not seniors so much being able to smell their food, which we'll talk about in a second, but it's being able to smell key hazards such as gas in the home, smoke, or burning food. Those can be big safety hazards. So those are certainly something to consider. And as I just mentioned, smell also has an effect on, you know, smelling the foods that we eat, and that can also affect our sense of taste, which is the next of the five senses. We start out with about 10,000 taste buds, and they decrease in both number and mass as we age. What some family members might not know is that medication might also decrease a senior's appetite, making them vulnerable to malnutrition. Because if you think about the impact that food has on us and our energy levels, if a senior's not able to smell or taste, they might not be eating nutritious and regular meals, which could cause them to be more lethargic and weak, which in turn could affect safety issues such as falls. So sometimes families aren't connecting these dots, and as professionals, we have to connect those for them. And then the last of our I skipped over touch. So touch can also be affected. There's a decrease in the blood flow to our nerve endings as we age, which can reduce a senior's sensitivity to pain and temperature. So when you think about when a senior turns on water, they might not be able to feel the water coming out of the faucet as to whether or not it's too hot or cold. So that's something to keep an eye out for. And then losing feelings in our toes as our seniors age can lead to that unsteady balance or gait, which could lead to a trip or fall. And then if there's a loss of nerve-ending feeling in our fingers, we might not grab onto a grab bar as tight as we need to, or not be able to feel things that might be harmful to us. So now the last one is hearing. I had jumped the gun earlier. But our ears control our hearing and our sense of balance, both which are compromised as we age. And older adults could miss out on an important visitor or a service call if they can't hear the doorbell. Or worse, they might miss out on socialization with friends or family because they can't hear the conversation. And I've noticed this with my own grandma. We had big family get-togethers. You know, she would really disengage in the conversation or leave the room if we have a big family of, you know, 30 people. If we were all in there talking, it was too loud. She was very sensitive to hearing, but once she got hearing aids, we really noticed a big difference, and she was more engaged in conversation. So families need to pay attention to those types of signs as to whether or not their loved one can properly hear. So now that we know about the effects that aging can have on home safety, I want to go through all the rooms of the house quick and identify specific hazards in the physical environment. So let's transition to the house on the next slide. On Home Instead's website, makinghomesaferforseniors.com, you can see that there on the slide, there's a really neat interactive tool. This is kind of a snapshot of the tool here, and it takes families through the home room by room. And I'm going to walk us through the tool today to identify some of the key hazards, but you can direct families to this site and have them go through the tool. You can click on different hazards, and a pop-up box will explain why that might be a hazard and some modifications that might be recommended for that particular room of the house. So before we step into the home, we're going to take a look on the next slide at some potential hazards that exist outside of the house that we need to be aware of. So when it comes to the yard or the entryway to the home, of course, many seniors automatically think about weather. Here in Omaha today, we had a huge snowstorm, so there was lots of snow. But for seniors, you know, having that clear pathway free from ice and free from snow can make a big difference when entering and exiting the home. Also, clutter that might accumulate, such as hoses on the driveway or newspapers on the stairwell, those need to be paying attention to so the senior has a free path to move about the yard or getting in and out of the house. Also, those uneven cracks in the sidewalk or holes can be, again, a fall risk. And what I see most frequently is, especially on those split-level homes, there's oftentimes a staircase outside that leads from the driveway up to the front door. So making sure that there are proper handrails at any outdoor walkway or outdoor staircase is really key. And then is there adequate lighting, especially if the senior is going in and out at night? Could a sensor be installed, that motion sensor, so when somebody walks by the light flashes on, that could be helpful. And then again, that doorbell, you can see there's a little ding-dong right by the door on the slide there. Again, we've talked about what if the senior can't hear the doorbell? Is there another option, something that flashes that would indicate someone is at the door? And then is their address clearly visible from the street? And this is especially important for emergency personnel. And again, this is not something that families think of very often, but if there was a 911 call, could those emergency response personnel easily see the home number from the street? And then, of course, if the senior loved one has Alzheimer's or another form of dementia, wandering is always a risk and a safety hazard. So if they can easily get outside, that is a hazard, so we need to address that by adding a doorbell kind of alarm that when a door opens, there's a noise so that somebody knows that the loved one might be exiting the home, or adding additional locks to secure the home. So now that we've addressed the outside of the house, let's take a step inside to the living room and check out the potential hazards there. First of all, you need to consider, is there adequate lighting? And can the seniors reach the switches for the lighting easily? You know, one option, if they're not able to reach the lighting, is to rearrange the furniture so that they can access the light switch. Or you can, again, use those motion-sensored lights or a clap-on, clap-off. We all remember those commercials. Or put lamps on timers. I even at my own house have a lamp on a timer that turns on when I get up in the morning. So it's already on in my living room when I come downstairs, so that you could use timers for seniors if they are in certain rooms at key times of the day. And also consider, is there too much clutter? I'm sure we've all seen, you know, the hoarder type situations, but that can be really dangerous and be a fall hazard if there is clutter in the walkways. And one type of clutter could be those tangled electrical cords. I've seen cords be a big issue in a lot of the homes of seniors that I work with. So it's best to suggest to families that they run electrical cords behind furnishings, or maybe even rearrange lamps or things that need to be plugged in so that we can keep those cords out of the walkways. And then is the furniture stable? Many seniors have that favorite chair that they've been sitting in for years and years, and so the cushion might not be as flush as it used to be, so you find the senior really having to push themselves up out of the chair, and a quick fix to that would be to buy a big piece of thick foam and stick that under the cushion to elevate the senior a little higher. But again, have the family members put themselves in the senior's shoes, sit down in the furniture that they sit in, make sure that it's stable, or watch their loved ones get up and down out of the furniture, off the furniture that they're using most frequently, to make sure that they are able to move about the home freely. So on the next slide, we're going to transition to the kitchen, which, as I'm sure you all know, has many potential hazards. And I would say one of the biggest ones, again, that families don't always think about, is spoiled food in the refrigerator. And, of course, some of the hazards of spoiled food would be food poisoning. So if an older adult is unable to go through their refrigerator on a regular basis and throw away expired food, you might want to have the family members go over there regularly or hire somebody to come in, like a home care provider, and go through the fridge with them somewhat regularly. If the senior likes to cook meals in bulk, they could encourage the senior to freeze portions of it for later use. That way, the food doesn't expire. And then, of course, there's the risk of sharp utensils or knives in the kitchen area. And if there is Alzheimer's or dementia in the situation, it might even pose a greater risk. So make sure that if they need to be stored and secure, that those items are. And then it's a good idea to have a lightweight fire extinguisher in the home that's in an easy-to-reach area. And accessibility is huge in the kitchen. We want to make sure that their workstations where the senior can prepare the food is easily accessible. Maybe it's in a place where a senior can pull up a chair and sit down while they prepare the food, especially if there's weakness in the legs, that sort of thing. And then the microwave, you know, a lot of times the microwave is elevated. Does that microwave need to come down from above the stove and be placed on the countertop so that the senior can easily access it? Or are they storing pots and pans down low where they're having to bend over to pick up these heavy pots and pans? Again, have the family members put themselves in the senior's shoes. Watch them have the family member watch the senior make a meal so they can see, you know, the areas of the kitchen they're accessing most frequently, and then see if the kitchen can be rearranged to put those pots and pans at accessible heights. Even, you know, I've seen hooks being installed where they can hang hot, frequently used pots and pans so that the senior doesn't have to, again, reach underneath to reach those frequently used items. And then, again, lighting, especially when there's chopping involved or in the frequently used areas like the stove and the sink, make sure that those have adequate lighting. There's really cheap battery-operated lights that you can stick up underneath the cabinets that you can click. You can find them at any home improvement store. Those are quick fixes. And then when it comes to the water, I mean, this goes for all rooms of the home, but making sure that the water temperature is controlled. And then for those that have really arthritic hands, making sure that the senior can, if there are knobs, easily turn the knobs. And if it is an option, perhaps a lever would be a nice alternative to the traditional knobs so that the senior can still operate faucet easily, but it's a little bit easier on their hands. So again, it's all about creating an environment where senior can be still be independent, but do so in a safe manner. Something else important to consider, I've seen this in a lot of homes, is on the refrigerator, make sure that the senior has some of those emergency contacts listed on the refrigerator, maybe even a medication list on there in case of an emergency. Emergency personnel kind of know, it's kind of an unwritten rule, or maybe it is a written rule, that a lot of times those emergency contacts and that emergency information is stored on the refrigerator. So that's one last safety improvement, I guess you could say, or safety implementation that's easy to do for a family when it comes to the kitchen. So if we transition to the bedroom, there's a few safety hazards here that I wanted to highlight. When you think about a senior getting out of bed in the morning or going to bed at night, you want to make sure that they're able to get in and out of the bed properly. There's really easy fixes, little blocks or plastic risers that you can, again, purchase at most home improvement stores that you can put under each leg of the bed to rise the bed up a little bit if it's easier for a senior to get out of bed if it's a little bit higher. And then you also want to make sure, again, that it's free of clutter. Sometimes in the bedrooms is where I see the most tight places. You know, the bed's kind of up against the wall, or there's a dresser, especially if a senior has a walker or some sort of mobility device. You want to make sure that they can get around the bedroom easily and make sure that the pathways are clear. So if that means moving an end table out or away from the bed a little bit more, that might be a good idea. And speaking of the end table, is there a telephone, a cell phone, something that the senior could access, or emergency response button that the senior could push if there's an emergency in the middle of the night? That's something to consider, especially if a senior were to fall. That emergency response button is a huge home safety or an opportunity for the senior to be safer in the home if they have access to that emergency response button. And then make sure, again, that there's enough lighting. In the closet, a lot of times it can be dark or unlit. So, again, those push lights can be attached to the closet door, or a light can be installed above in the closet to create some more light, especially when they're picking out their outfits in the morning. So, again, those are some highlights of the bedroom. And then the next one, the bathroom, is what we'll transition to on the next slide. And according to the survey of ER doctors in the U.S. and Canada, 69% of home injuries occur in the bathroom. And that's really due to a variety of safety reasons, slippery floors. Oftentimes, seniors are going from a sitting to standing position. They might trip over something. So there's lots of hazards here. And the most important safety implementation that you can put in your bathroom would be grab bars. Those are relatively inexpensive. Have one near the shower, near the tub, near the toilet. So the senior can really grab onto those and pull themselves up. I find a lot of times, and I'm sure many of you have walked into a senior's home where the towel bar is broken, and that's because the senior is trying to pull themselves up on that towel bar, or they'll open the cabinet underneath the sink and try to push themselves up by using the cabinet, and then the cabinet door will kind of break. I'm sure you're all kind of nodding your heads along. We've all seen this. So those grab bars can, one, reduce the number of falls and also save those towel bars and cabinets from being destroyed. And then some other simple, really simple shower modifications, a shower bench where a senior can sit down and then move their feet over into the tub. That can be really helpful. An adjustable shower head that a senior can remove off the wall and shower themselves safely. Those non-skid mats in the tub. And then the rugs outside of the tub can be a fall hazard, but they can also prevent a slippery surface. So if you do have some rugs, you want to be sure to use one that has a non-skid backing, or a more rubber mat that's more secure that a senior can step down onto. Another thing to consider, a lot of seniors store their medications in their bathroom. I know that's where I keep my medications. So make sure that they're stored properly, not too high, not too low, or if in the case of someone who has memory or cognitive issues, make sure that those medications are stored in a safe environment. And then, again, the water temperature is always something to keep in the back of your mind when it comes to the bathroom. And also, one thing that I come in contact with a lot is a senior that's not able to get up and down off the toilet very easily. If the senior doesn't want to install a grab bar, you can always adjust the toilet height by getting a toilet seat riser, or there's even different modifications you can make to the toilet to make that more accessible. Even installing a new toilet if they're doing some home remodeling, take that toilet height into consideration. So lots of things, lots of potential hazards here in the bathroom, in the shower area. But now let's move on the next slide to the hallway. And while it's not a place that people hang out in, there can be quite a few hazards in the hallway that people don't always consider. In a lot of hallways is where the smoke detectors are, or alarms are usually kept for carbon monoxide or, again, the smoke detector. So make sure that those are working, that there are smoke detectors in the home, and check them regularly. And if the senior does not have them, oftentimes the local fire department will come in and install smoke detectors for free. So you can always look into that. One frequent trip through a hallway would be to the bathroom, especially at nighttime. So make sure that the senior is able to access the bathroom easily. And a quick fix there might be a motion-sensored nightlight or, you know, rope lighting that guides them to the bathroom has some lighting. You can always just tape that down to the carpet, especially in a case where there's Alzheimer's or dementia. They often follow that light trail right to the bathroom, so that can be very, very helpful. And then when it comes to hallways, sometimes they're pretty narrow, so it might be difficult for a wheelchair or a walker to get through, especially narrow doorways. So standard hinges can be replaced with what's called a swing clear hinge, which allows the door to clear or swing clear open, which actually gives another at least 1 inch. And I've found that to be extremely helpful, especially when somebody, you know, was temporarily using a wheelchair. Instead of having to widen the entire doorway, they just get that swing clear hinge that allows for that smooth opening. All right, so the next room of the house that we're going to look into is the laundry room or the basement. For many people, their laundry room is in their basement, and for seniors, especially when it comes to the mobility, if they're trying to juggle a laundry basket, that can be a severe risk for falls if they're going down the stairs with that laundry basket. So I guess the first question for families to consider is, can the senior carry the laundry basket up and down? If not, can the senior wait to do laundry until an adult child comes over? Or can they bring in outside help from home care or a volunteer, somebody come over and bring the laundry downstairs or do it for them altogether? When it comes to the laundry detergent, are those boxes or bottles heavy for the senior to lift? Sometimes to save money, people buy those big, bulky detergent bottles, but for a senior, that might be difficult to lift. So is there an alternate solution, buying a smaller bottle or refilling a smaller one from a bulk bottle? Those are quick, easy fixes that can really help a senior, again, stay independent and be able to do their own laundry. And then when it comes to those stairs that are taking them down to the basement, is there a handrail? Is it safe? Is it secure? Ideally, you want a handrail on each side if mobility is a big issue. And in that stairwell, is there adequate lighting? Is it free of clutter? I find that especially at the top and the bottom of the stairs, that's where those magazines pile up or something, some items that the senior is wanting to take downstairs with them the next time, so they put it there so that they'll remember, but those end up being trip hazards. So those are things to watch out for. And if there's not good lighting in the stairwell, of course, there are quick fixes for increasing the lighting, but you might also want to consider putting a piece of brightly colored duct tape along the edge of the stairs so that the senior can see clearly where the stair ends. All right, so one last room of the house that we're going to take a peek at is the garage. And while some people might not consider this a room of the house, there are some potential hazards there. And again, back to the stairs, there, in most garages I've seen, there's at least one or two stairs in or out of the garage. And those are the places that are least likely to have a railing. But that's one staircase that I see most always seniors are using. You know, they're taking those couple stairs down to get in the car, to go to the doctor, the grocery store. So in placing a handrail there, you can really help to increase the safety of those couple stairs. And then also our power tools, lawn chemicals, lawn mowers, in the case of memory issues, are the keys secure? Are all those items secure? There's a lot of hazards that can exist in these garages. And is there trash piling up? You can see that there on the slide. And we'll talk about trash a little bit more in the next slide. But one last thing to consider is the garage secure? You know, is if it's a detached garage, you know, is that secure? If it's attached to the house, could a potential intruder enter through the garage? You always just want to be keeping the safety of the house and the garage in mind. All right, so now we've gone through each room of the house. There's just a few more key specifics when it comes to safety that I wanted to address on the next slide. And we touched on a lot of these that are listed there on your slide already, but I wanted to point out a few things specifically under each of those bullet points. Now, when it comes to surfaces, we haven't really talked yet about tile or hardwood floors, and I see those a lot in senior homes. And that's a hard one because those usually exist in, you know, the kitchens, the bathrooms, and rugs aren't always the best solution. You know, you can sometimes do the rubber mats or put a non-skid lining underneath the rug. But if a senior is really adamant about, you know, walking a lot on those hardwood floors, make sure that they're wearing proper footwear. So whether that's well-fitted shoes or socks with non-skid soles, those are really good options for preventing falls, or at least reducing the risk for falls. And then when it comes to clutter, we've talked a lot about clutter already, but encourage families to do kind of a spring cleaning with their loved one to get organized, declutter, maybe add a shelving unit, especially if they like to pile books or magazines, a magazine rack, those types of things, to get those things that would usually be on the floor, off the floor, and in a designated spot. And then, again, I've talked about eliminating furniture to increase the amount of space. That is one option. We want to encourage wide pathways, clear pathways. So if there's a lot of clutter around, if there's at least wide pathways, that can be a way to reduce the fall risk, because we know sometimes people just don't want to give up that clutter. And then the kitchen, a way to reduce clutter on the kitchen counter is to use a lazy Susan so that the senior can still get to all the items that they need, but it's a little more organized and they don't have to reach clear across the counter for things. And when it comes to lighting and glare, families need to keep in mind that at different times of the day, the lighting in each room might be different and different times of the year. So keep those in mind. Maybe spend a time at the senior's home at different points in the day to see where maybe night lights or extra lighting or another lamp might be beneficial. And then again, pay attention to those switches, those lamps, where they turn on, can the senior access those? And then that takes us right into the next bullet point of access. We need to make sure that the things that they're using on a regular basis are accessible to the seniors, especially those items they're using every day. So have the family members put themselves in their loved one's shoes. Again, maybe kind of just observe while they're over at their loved one's house to see, you know, the places in the home, places in each room where they're going to be accessing things frequently, and make sure that those aren't too high or too low. At, you know, eye level is a good place to store things. And then when it comes to chemicals and tools, we've again addressed this, but make sure that they're secure, make sure that they're at an accessible place for the senior to access them, especially if there's Alzheimer's or dementia, if there's chemicals that might be hazardous, make sure that those are locked and secured. And then when it comes to trash, trash is something that families don't always think about. They might think about getting the trash taken out for their senior loved ones to the curb, but one tip that I find is smaller trash cans are better. You know, the senior might have to make more trips to the outside trash can to dispose of their trash, but the smaller trash cans mean smaller trash bags, so they're not as heavy for the senior to lift and carry, and it also gives them some more exercise. So kind of incorporating a few of the things we've talked about. And in many communities, if a senior can't take their trash can out to the curb, a neighbor, a family member can't do that for them, a lot of times they have options within the community If you contact your local trash collector, that they can put the trash cans right outside the garage door, and the trash personnel will come up to the garage and take that out for them. So, again, there's a lot of community resources that families just aren't aware of. So, as professionals, we can give them those resources. So, I'm going to share a few more of those on the next slide. In conjunction with the University at Buffalo, Home Instead built a home safety checklist. You can see that up in the top right hand of your slide there. And you can have families download that at makinghomesaferforseniors.com, and I'll have that website again for you on the resource slide in just a few minutes. But again, this takes you through the house, just kind of like we did, every room, but it's more detailed, more comprehensive, and it's a good checklist that families can print off once a year. And that's something else when it comes to home safety. It's not like a one-and-done situation. It's not like, okay, we assess mom's house that one time for safety, we're good. Not the case. As a senior's needs change, their home safety concerns will change as well. So it's a good idea to pick one day of the year, whether it's New Year's Day or during spring cleaning, to go through this checklist, the family members and the loved one, just to make sure that the senior's needs are still being met within the home and that the senior is still feeling safe at home. And then we also came up with some 5 fixes under $500. We partnered with the Certified Aging in Place Specialist with the National Association of Home Builders. And I won't read them off here. We've kind of talked about a lot of those. But again, you can download that on makinghomesaferforseniors.com. All right. So communication is always key when it comes to these types of issues. So I'm going to end with some communication tips on the next slide when it comes to the topic of home safety. And in a lot of my webinars, if you've been tuning in, you'll hear me say that communication is key. And I think that that is true for so many topics, and especially this one. So as you guys visit with these families every day, it's important to convey that we need to include the seniors in the conversation around home safety. It's a lot of times it's hard to be the family caregiver because their role is really being reversed. Their parents used to parent them, and now they're feeling like they're parenting their parents, and they're having to protect them and ensure that they're safe. But the senior still can contribute to this conversation. They can still give their input. So it's important for families to involve them in the conversation and try to keep the conversation helpful and positive. Arguing, the first point there is do not argue. Arguing will not do any good, so it's important for families to remain calm. And remember that this is a sensitive topic because a senior might feel like they're losing their independence. So we want to make sure that their dignity and respect is intact. And we need to remind families that they can explain to their senior loved one, you know, we're doing this to help you stay at home. We're not trying to take away your independence. We're trying to help you maintain that independence. Because as we've seen so many times in our line of work, if a senior falls and ends up in the hospital, you know, their chances of falling again increase. Their mobility a lot of times is compromised. It takes them a while to recover and get back to their original point of health if they're even able to get back. So if we can prevent falls, that can go a long way in keeping a senior safe at home. And then also we want to, again, work with the seniors. Make it a team approach. Talk with them, stay on the seniors' agenda, make sure they understand why you're trying to help. And we also, again, need to be empathetic to the senior, put yourself in their shoes as the family caregiver, put yourself in your senior loved one's shoes. And then finally, listen to them. A lot of times as family caregivers, we don't want to listen, we just do. We just want to do things, we want to get it done, we want to check it off our list, move on to our next thing. But if we really take the time to listen to the senior, have this conversation, ask them, you know, do you feel safe at home? Are there any of the areas of the house that you're not feeling safe? Are you considering any home modifications? Is there anything I could do in the house to make it easier for you to get around, for you to feel more safe? So include them in the conversation. Really listen to their needs because they might clue you into something that you've never even thought of before. and also if they're part of the conversation and a part of the solution, they're more likely to be accepting of that, and it'll make the process a lot smoother. So I'm going to pull up the resources slide here on the next page and just highlight a couple resources. We have that University at Buffalo Home Safety Assessment Tool, and the website is there. Also, the Certified Aging in Place Specialists, you can visit that website. MakingHomeSaferForSeniors.com, I've talked a lot about that. That interactive tool is on there. You can also download Home Safety Assessment, those five fixes under $500. And then, of course, the National Safety Council and the Canada Safety Council. Those websites are listed there. So bottom line is seniors, they can remain at home a lot longer if their environment is safe. And so families need to have those conversations with their loved one and make those home modifications in a proactive way rather than reactive because of a fall or because of an accident that occurred in the home. So with that, I'm going to throw it back over to you, Steve. We'll open it up for questions. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them for you. Or if you have any additional resources that you want to share with the group, please feel free to do that at this time.
All right. Thank you very much, Lakeland. Great presentation as always. Yes, everyone, it is time for the Q&A. Portion of today's webinar. So if you have any questions here that you want to talk to Lakeland about, please send them in to using the questions box that you can see right there. Lakeland, if you are ready, we will get to it right here. First question here for you, how would you address pets with seniors? It can be a potential problem there.
Absolutely. You know, this is a hard one because for a lot of people, pets can be a source of companionship, a source of comfort, but they can also be a trip hazard, a fall hazard. If a senior gets to a point when they're unable to properly care for an animal, that can become an issue. So I'm not sure of the circumstances of the situation, whether, the animal is causing falls within the home. You know, if that's the case, you want to be mindful of the senior's independence, again, but maybe we could limit the pet's access to certain areas of the home. Maybe if while the senior is cooking, making sure that the dog is, in the living room with a safety gate up, keeping them out, or maybe in the kennel, times when the senior is moving around. Another option, if they're unable to care for the animal, could hire a pet service. In some communities that's available, if a loved one could come over to let the dog out, or a neighbor could come over, because for a lot of seniors, they don't have the mobility to get up and let the dog out, or if they have memory issues, they don't always forget to feed the dog or give the dog water, those types of things. So again, it's very situational, but at the end of the day, it's about the senior's safety. So if a family is really concerned about the pet and how it's affecting the senior's safety, it might be a good idea to remove the pet from the home. And if the senior is resistant to that, you could always offer up and say, can we let the pet come over to my house for just a couple weeks and see how it goes, and then maybe if there's a cognition problem, they might forget that the pet has left the home, or maybe in that time there's some home modifications that can be made to keep the senior safer while the dog is there. We want the senior to be safe, and also we want the animal to be well cared for. So if the senior is unable to care for the pet, it might be a good idea to remove it from the home. And a lot of the local humane societies can help find those animals good homes if a family member is not willing or able to, care for the pet on their own. So I hope I gave some tips. Without knowing the exact circumstance, it's hard to answer that directly, but if you want more resources, caregiverstress.com is always a good place to start.
Yes, great. Next question here for you, Lakeland. A key issue is getting seniors to agree to in-home supports and changes. The seniors we work with tend to refuse any changes, even when they acknowledge the risk. So how would you address a situation like this, which has got to be more common than common?
Yes, it is. It can be very common. And, you know, for some seniors, no matter how many different times and ways you try to explain, you know, having assistance in the home will help, or making these modifications will help. Sometimes it's very difficult to convince them otherwise. In a lot of the families that I've worked with, the conversation, while it's tough to have, you know, discussing the alternatives to not making these home modifications, whether that's having to move out of the home, move to an assisted living, or even some modifications within those environments need to take place as well. You know, if the senior can be part of the solution, that is always kind of a good approach. You know, if you talk to them about, you know, okay, we need to make these home modifications, and if you don't, you know, we might have to move you elsewhere. If that doesn't motivate them, you know, try to involve them in the decision making. So if a grab bar needs to be installed, then, you know, give them a few options. You know, you could have a silver grab bar, you could have a black one. You know, trying to make them feel that they're still somewhat in control of the situation can go a long way. So if you're having to rearrange the furniture to accommodate for a walker or something of that sort, and the senior is just not, you know, allowing or is very resistant to that, you could always give them options on where to move it, or, you know, if a smaller piece of furniture from the living room could fit there, give them those kinds of options. But it can be difficult, and again, at the end of the day, sometimes your senior loved ones, they just can't get past the change. Sometimes families can kind of negotiate with the senior too and say, you know, how about we take the rug away, because rugs are a big one that a lot of, especially my female clients, they don't like to give up their pretty rugs in the hallway. You know, hey, let's just try it for a few days, see how it goes, that sort of thing. So I hope that those are some good suggestions. Again, on the Making Home Safer for Senior website, there's some more conversation starters on there. You could always go there for some additional tips on that. But good question.
Okay, Lakeland. Next question is, I've got a kind of bunch of similar ones here, so I'm going to try to put them all under the same umbrella. A lot of these solutions may be cost prohibitive for a lot of lower income or pretty much anybody. Do you have any recommendations for cost-prohibitive solutions or anything like that? Would they be subsidized by Medicare or Medicaid? Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, that's a good point. There are some modifications that are pricey, while some are less expensive, easy to implement kind of solutions. I know, at least in my community, the local area agency on aging, they do have like home improvement programs, those types of things. I believe they a lot of times are income-based, so for these individuals that might not be able to afford those types of services, that would be a good option. There's also a lot of the local area agency on aging is a great contact to get there. The website to figure out which area agency on aging is closest to the senior is the letter N, the number 4, the letter A, n4a.org. So you can type in the senior zip code. I wanted to make sure you all got that. But and the local area agency on aging also a lot of times is in the know of local, you know, not-for-profits that will modify a senior's home or make accommodations. I know in my local community there is an organization that will install ramps, for example, a modification for a senior in the home. So I would definitely reach out to the local area agency on aging to see if they have any home safety types of programs or subsidies that are available. And I know, and we didn't really even touch on this, but, you know, heating and cooling, air conditioning and a lot, that's a big safety concern for a lot of seniors, especially, you know, in the winter months and the the hot summer climate, having a temperature-controlled environment is important to their health and safety. So if a senior is having difficulty paying those heating and cooling bills, those types of things, again, the Area Agency on Aging is a great resource for seniors to go to for assistance on those types of things. So that's a great question. I know not all these fixes are ideal for everyone, but again, those little fixes, rearranging things in the home, making sure that things are easily accessible, those inexpensive little push lights or bed risers or piece of foam that you can put under cushions, those are more affordable, small items, small modifications that seniors could make. So I hope that that gave some at least a place to start.
All right, Lakeland, well, we're just about out of time today, but I want to thank you for a great presentation. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you so much, Steve. Have a great day, everyone.
Thanks for joining us for today's webinar, everybody. We do appreciate it. We want to thank Homestead Senior Care for their ongoing support of this webinar series called the Family Caregiver Support Webinar Series, doing them monthly. If you want to receive the CEUs, please just sit tight. You'll be receiving a follow-up email by the end of the business day today that's going to contain a link to the CEU application as well as the slides, as well as a link to the next event in this series coming up in March, coming up very soon. So watch out for that follow-up email coming your way by the end of the business day today. Again, we want to thank you for joining us for today's webinar, everybody. Peace, love, and soul to you.